prapanna parijataya totra vetraikapanaye jnanamudraya krishnaya gita amruta duhe namaha om. Dear friends, welcome to the study of Gita. We are seeing the shloka number 8 of 14th chapter. We are reading this 14th chapter, that is gunatraya vibhaga yoga, that is the study of the three gunas, the constituents in the prakriti. And we know that these three constituents, sattva, rajas and tamas, the whole universe, everything, right from a small amoeba or rather a microbe, right up to an elephant, all things, all beings, they are all products of these three gunas. They are all mixtures of these three gunas. So that is what we have been seeing. And we are not bothered about elephants, lions, etc. We are bothered about human beings. How do these gunas, or rather the constituents, sattva, rajas and tamas, manifest in the human beings? And we have to remember that there is no person who is 100% sattva guna, 100% rajoguna or 100% tamoguna. In every person, even if he is a saint, there is some little bit of tamoguna, some little bit of rajoguna. And even in a rajoguna, highly rajas dominating person, even in him there is some sattva guna, also there is some tamoguna. And even in the tamoguna person, at some point of time there is some little bit of sattva guna which comes up, and also some rajoguna. So it is like that. So sattva guna, these three gunas, or rather constituents in the universe, they manifest in the human beings in several forms. We were reading the tamoguna. We just saw yesterday the manifestation of sattva and rajas in the human beings. And we also read the shloka. We were somewhere in the middle. That is 8th shloka. Tamastva jnanajam vidhi mohanam sarvadehinam pramadalasya nidrabhihi tan nibadhanati bharata. Oh Arjuna, this tamas is something which binds a person. Of course, sattva guna also binds a person. Sattva guna also binds a person in pursuing some good activities. Rajoguna binds a person in pursuing some selfish, highly ambitious activities. He is always he is an achiever. He wants to achieve something. He wants to get this, that, etc. And tamoguna sometimes it is deluding in nature. Sometimes its nature is totally deluding in nature. And again, taking wrong decisions, a person taking some foolhardy decisions, a person who is only opinionated and says, yes, I don't want to. What I say is right. So something like that. Moha is total delusion and a sort of obstinate thinking. So pramada alasya nidrabhihi tan nibadhanati bharata. Moha is aviveka. That is, what is right and what is wrong. Inability to discriminate as to what is right and what is wrong. So basically, losing that ethical judgment, as we say. Losing that ethical judgment or ethical balance. So the commentators write, hita hita di viveka pratibandhakam, hita ahita, what is right and what is wrong. So that viveka, the discrimination, is not there. So that is the effect of tamoguna. We have any number of examples. For example, all the demons whom we see in the books. For example, Ravana, a highly learned man. For example, this tamoguna can be in a highly learned man also. A highly learned person, when he is having that rajoguna and tamoguna predominantly, it does not hamper him, it does not hamper his studies. A person may be a brilliant person, but at the same time, this rajoguna may be very, very dominant, and similarly, tamoguna also may be dominant, and because of that, he goes and does certain wrong things. Duryodhana also is a person who does only wrong things. So it is like that. So this hitam and ahitam. So for example, these rakshasas, it is a combination of this rajas and tamas. Rajas and tamas, that is trying to get something, achieve something, and not using the right path, not knowing what is right and what is wrong, and leading to wrong or unethical or incorrect or sinful behavior. Then we come to the next shloka. He is almost summarizing these three gunas, how they manifest in the human beings. He is summarizing in the 9th shloka. I will read the shloka. Sattvam sukhe sanjayati rajah karmani bharata jnanam avrutyatu tamaha pramade sanjayatyuta. So sattvam sukhe sanjayati, that is this sattva guna. Sattvam is sattva guna, that is this particular character, this particular constituent called sattva. It engages a person in happiness, engages or binds a person in happiness. It that is, a person who is in that state, he is just happy and contented with what he has, and he wants to have happiness from certain good pursuits. For example, he is interested in learning some shastra, so he is studying some shastra, he is happy. The joy of understanding, as we say, there is a word called the joy of understanding, phrase rather. So a person, he knows a particular science, he is happy. Or somebody who is a musician, so he sings and then he is happy. Somebody who is having some other art, he does that and he is very, very happy with that. And so like that. So, and also pursuit of knowledge, so he is happy. Sukhe sanjayati, sattva guna binds a person. Sanyojayati, sanjayati means it actually unites a person or attaches. Sanyojanam means making something unite with something else, that is bringing something together with something. So bringing together. So sattvam sukhe sanjayati means the sattva guna attaches a person to this sukham, or unites a person with sukham, or results in sukham. In other words, results in sukham. Because of his pursuits, he is quite contented, happy, pursuing some certain noble objectives or certain literary pursuits, etc. Then Rajaha Karmani Bharata. Bharata means, say Arjuna, he is addressing Arjuna. Rajaha means this Rajoguna. Karmani Sanjayati. Sanjayati applies to this also. Rajoguna. Karmani Sanjayati means Rajoguna always engages, always impels a person to do some action. Action, always doing something, always in pursuit of something. So these people, they just cannot take rest. They just cannot take rest, they just cannot relax, they just cannot enjoy music, they can just cannot enjoy anything. So even if, say, he is listening to some concert or something like that, so he is busy looking into his business developments, so it is like that. So the man, he has just no peace of mind, so he is always, right from morning till night, the morning starts with looking into that, that page relating to stock market. So that stock market page, we see so many people. The moment, the first thing they get up in the, they do in the morning is, while having some tea or coffee in the morning, they just go through all those things and that stock market page, and then they note down and what is happening to his stocks and whatnot. So the pursuit of artha starts right from the morning. We know earlier we were reading Ramayana. When we were reading Ramayana, we just saw in two or three different places how a person has to devote his time for dharma, artha and kama. That is, Ramayana says frequently, and also of course Mahabharata is also going to say. Mahabharata says, and also Ramayana says, a person has to devote his morning hours for pursuit of dharma. So he has to think of these dharmic activities, he has to think of some good things, he has to think of maybe his daily routine, prayers, etc. He has to pursue that dharma. And sometime in the, after the morning hour, maybe around 10 a.m. starting from that time, so is the day-to-day work and then whatever he has to do for his livelihood, because livelihood is very, very important. No dharma shastra or no book on ethics will say that you should not earn money. Dharma shastras very much say you have to earn money, you follow dharma, earn money and also spend money for good things, in addition to spending on yourself. So dharma, dharma in the morning, artha in the afternoon, and kama, whatever enjoyment, relaxation, desires and all that. You call it kama means not only in the physical sense, that is kama means that is husband-wife relationship, that is one kama. Not only that, you just go for a stroll or you just go to a concert. You go, say, just go to some dance program or something like that. And enjoy. So that is, enjoyment is something which is also needed for a human being. So dharma, artha and kama, we are supposed to apportion time during the day. So here it is not like that. Rajah karmani, this rajoguna man, right from morning till midnight, he is busy with his own business. Then jnanam avrutya tu tamaham. Jnanam avrutya tu. Tu means on the other hand. On the other hand, tamaha, what does it do? Tamaha, jnanam avrutya, having enveloped this jnanam, avrutya means having enveloped, this jnanam, having shrouded, having suppressed jnanam avrutya, pramade sanjayati. So if jnanam were to be there, this man would not commit wrong actions. Whereas jnanam is something which is avrutam, that is, it is something which is shrouded, which is concealed by this tamoguna. And the person, he is made to do certain wrong deeds. Pramada. Pramada means basically wrong deeds. Pramada is in Sanskrit. It is in Telugu we use the word to refer to some accident. Some road to pramadam we say. Pramada is not accident. Pramada is a wrong action. Pramada, anavadhanata, something due to inattentiveness, not following the right course of action. So all these things, that is pramada. That is doing a wrong action due to wrong judgment. So that is pramada. Pramade sanjayat yuta. Uta means even. This sanjaya, rajoguna, it even leads a person to wrong acts, not only shrouds judgment, but also makes him do certain wrong deeds, wrong actions. So, not merely failing in one's own duty, but also doing some wrong actions. Then we come to the next shloka, that is the 10th shloka. 10th shloka says, it is again this is how these three gunas, how they interact with one another. So, this we know that these three gunas, there is sattva-guna on one side, rajo-guna and tamo-guna. What is the internal relationship? Are they peaceful? Or are they always trying to dominate one another? So what this shloka says is, at different points of time in history, at some point of time in history, sattva-guna dominates. At some other point of time in history, rajo-guna dominates, suppressing the other two. At some other point in history, in the course of time, let me say, so this tamo-guna dominates, suppressing the other two. We'll just take a break and see this shloka. Let us resume. We have to see this shloka number 10, which is going to tell us about how this sattva guna dominates at times, and then rajo guna some other times it dominates, and tamo guna at some other times it dominates. What does this shloka say? Rajas tamascha vibhuya sattvam bhavati bharata, rajas sattvam tamaschaiva, tamas sattvam rajas tatha. Rajaha tamaha cha abhibhuya sattvam bhavati bharata. He Bharata, O Arjuna. So rajaha tamascha abhibhuya. Abhibhuya means having suppressed. Abhibhavanam. Abhibhavanam means suppressing. Abhibhuya means having suppressed. Having suppressed this rajoguna and tamoguna, that is ambitious tendencies, etc., they are all kept under control. Tamoguna also is kept under control, and sometimes sattvaguna is prospering. So when sattvaguna in some societies, for example, in we talk about Krita Yuga, Treta Yuga, Dwapara Yuga, and Kali Yuga. We say that we read in the Puranas that in the Krita Yuga, this Dharma Devata is compared to a bull. This Dharma Devata is compared to a bull which is walking on four legs. Naturally, bull has four legs. So in Krita Yuga, Dharma Devata was walking on all the four legs. Then that means Sattva Guna was predominant. Sattva Guna was predominant. There were more people who were following. It means sattva guna was predominant, means more people following sattva and very few people having that rajo guna and tamo guna. People were more gentle, contented, they were all peace loving, and they were all trying to see what is the, they were trying to have a social harmony. So that was the sattva guna. Later ages we see Treta Yuga, according to our Puranas, one leg is gone. So Dharma is walking on three legs. So that is a metaphor given. So that means there is some little bit of Rajoguna is gaining ground. And when you come to Dwapara Yuga, this Dharma Devata is only walking on two legs. This bull is walking only on two legs. It is very, very difficult. But anyway, it is walking on two legs. So that is... Rajoguna is much more predominant, and even Tamoguna has arisen. That is what we see in Dwapara Yuga, which is the age of Krishna, and that is the age during in which this Mahabharata war has taken place. And now, after the demise of Krishna, right from that time, the time is counted, and Krishna is said to have died about 5,000 years ago. And his time, prior to him, it was Dwapara Yuga. And after his death, the Kali Yuga starts. And now, Dharma Devata is said to be walking on one leg. Of course, it is all metaphorical. We have to take it, in a figurative way. So, Dharma Devata is walking on one leg, means with one leg that bull is hopping. So, that is how it means. So, which means this Tamo Guna has risen. Which means people are having a greater propensity for doing wrong things. That is perceiving right as wrong and wrong as right. And as Shakespeare says, foul is fair and fair is foul and foul is fair. So, that Macbeth, the three witches, they say, yes, fair is foul and foul is fair. So, that is the situation in the Kali Yuga. Probably Shakespeare also had the same vision. Because all great people, they have the same vision. So, this Sattva Guna at one point of time, having suppressed or having controlled this Rajoguna and Tamoguna, Sattvam Abhibhuya Bhavati, by subduing, Abhibhuya means having subdued this Rajoguna and Sattvaguna, Rajoguna and this Tamoguna, Sattvam dominates at some point of time. Then some other point of time, Rajas Sattvam Tamascheiva, Rajaha Sattvam Ramascheiva, Sattvam Tamascheiva. This Rajoguna, what does it do? At some other points of time, when Rajoguna is very predominant, all these kings and all these people, they were very, very predominant. They have subdued this Sattvaguna and also Tamoguna, and they were predominant. So maybe that was sometime during Treta Yuga or something like that. And this Tamaha, Sattvam Rajastatha, and Tamoguna at some other point of time, Tamoguna, what does it do? It suppresses what is this Sattvaguna and also Rajoguna. Tatha means in a similar manner. So that is what we see. This is the fluctuation, or this is the ups and downs of Sattvaguna, Rajoguna and Tamoguna. At some point of time, each one tries to dominate, and there is no equilibrium at any point. And one more thing, if you see the world history also, this Sattva, if the society has to run in a smooth manner, this Sattvaguna and Rajoguna have to go together. This is what we saw in the beginning of in the beginning of fourth chapter we saw a concept called Rajarshi. Rajarshi is Rajanaschate Rushayascha. That is, they are a king, he is a king, and at the same time a saintly king, which means an enlightened king. An enlightened king is somebody in which there is a mixture of the Sattva and Rajas, both are fairly well dominant, and Tamoguna is totally down. Of course, Tamoguna may be there a little bit. So, but then Sattva and Rajoguna, they are there, and Sattvaguna is actually guiding the Rajas. So, that is where this Shankaracharya and other commentators also have written, this Gita and also the Karma Yoga has been told not for sannyasis. Gita specifically, Shankaracharya says, Jagat Palaitrunam Kshatriyanam Baladhanaya. Gita has been told in order to give moral courage to the kings. So, in order to make the kings saintly kings, not selfish kings. Gita's purpose is to make the kings morally perfect, to make them morally strong. So, that is the idea. And Brahma Kshatre Paripalite Jagat Paripalayitu Malam, one more line he says, that is, these two things, the Sattvaguna and Rajoguna, when they are very well balanced, then upon such persons, they are fit to rule the whole universe. So that is what he says. So the ideal situation is that Sattvaguna and Rajoguna have to be properly there. That means we usually say politics and morality, or politics and ethics, they do not go together. A person who is in politics, he has to be necessarily crooked. That is what we think. It should not be so. That is what says Gita. It should not be so. This Sattvaguna and Rajoguna, they have to be equally there in a ruler. Then he is a person who is fit to rule the world. So, of course, you find certain examples in other cultures also. We read about King Solomon. King Solomon was supposed to be a very great king. Similarly, King David. Of course, Gita specifically talks about this concept of Rajarshi. And Plato, in his book, what is that Republic? He talks, his ideal republic is something which is ruled by a philosopher king. And writing about Plato, the story of a philosophy by Will Durant, I like that book very much, Philosophy, Story of Philosophy by Will Durant. Will Durant writes, what Plato conceived as an ideal, it was not realized in the Western society. That is what he writes. So he doesn't give any examples of any king, philosopher king, but he says that was an ideal of Plato. So that same thing, of course, we see in Gita, Rajarshi, Imam Rajarshayo Viduhu. And Gita gives examples of such Rajarshis. Earlier, all the old Rajarshis, there were so many Rajarshis, and the Gita and Mahabharata gives the stories of such Rajarshis, philosopher kings. So then, we come to the next shloka. The next shloka is, yes, it is talking, it is again telling, just slightly elaborating what it told earlier, because all this is a question of, there is a lot of discussion on what is morality and what is ethics. Incidentally, not merely the sattva-guna, rajoguna, tamoguna. It is all a lesson on ethics only. So this shloka is talking about the sattva-gunas, the prevalence of sattva-guna, the prevalence of this thing called sattva-guna is seen or noticed in a person if you see these following conditions, or when sattva-guna is prevalent, you see these following symptoms, or we can say symptoms also. When sattva-guna is predominant in a person, you see the following symptoms. What are those things? Sarvadvareshu deheesmin. This is 11th shloka. Sarvadvareshu deheesmin prakasha upajayate jnanam yada tada vidyat vivruddham satyamityuta. Sarvadvareshu deheesmin, dehe asmin, asmin dehe, in the body mind complex. Deha means not merely the physical body, but the entire body mind complex. Sarvadvareshu, what are all the dwara, the doors which we are having? All these doors of perception, what we call the sense of sight, the sense of touch, etc., etc., all these five senses, and also the mind. So these are all the doors, and also there are organs of action. My mind wants something, my hand executes it, or my legs execute it. So, like that. So, similarly, all this sarvadvareshu prakashaha upajayate. That means, all these, in fact, prakasha upajayate means, wisdom actually shines through all these, all our doors of perception. Sir, all the doors, let us say. Wisdom shines through all the doors. Sarvadvareshu deheesmin prakasha upajayate. That is, wisdom shines through all the doors. What does it mean? So that means wisdom shines through my eyes. Means what? That means whatever I see things rightly. And suppose I speak, wisdom shines through my speech, let us say. That means whatever I say, it is right or it is truthful. And whatever I do, it is truthful. Whatever I try to enjoy, it is something which is ethical, which is legal, which is moral, and which is truthful. So that means whatever action a person does, it is something which is purified. It is a very pure conduct. So, sarvadvareshu deheesmin prakasha upajayate. Prakasha upajayate means that is shining through wisdom, shining through these doors means. So he is perceiving things rightly. He is doing things rightly. When he perceives things rightly, when his understanding is right, his actions are right. Prakasha upajayate jnanam yada. So this prakasham, prakasha upajayate, that is prakasha eva jnanam. That is, this prakasha itself is jnanam. So this perceiving things rightly, whatever he sees, whatever we speak, etc., and whatever we do, it is all right. So that is, through every door, the light of intelligence manifests. And then you know that sattva has gained supremacy. Jnanam yada tada vidyat. Tada vidyat means at that time, vidyat, one has to know. Vidyat means one should know. Sattva, vivruddham sattvam ityuta. Vivruddham sattvam, that is sattva guna, has gained ground. Or sattva guna is an ascendancy. Sattva guna has gained victory over the other two. So that is what it is. That is, through every door of perception, the light of intelligence shines through. When that happens, then one has to know that sattva guna has gained ground. Then, vivruddham satyam ityuta. Then we come to the next shloka about rajoguna. When Rajoguna gains ground, how does it manifest in a person? We know already, but it tells in a very different way. Because all these things belong, relate to basically moral and ethical issues. So that is the reason why Krishna is also repeating. So he says, that is the 12th shloka. Lobhah pravruttir arambhah karmanam ashamaspruha rajasyetani jayante vivruddhe bharatarshabha. So here again he is addressing Arjuna as he bharatarshabha. Bharata plus rushabha becomes bharatarshabha. Rushabha means a bull. Bharatarshabha means a bull among the Bharata, in the Bharata clan. Not like a bull in a china shop. But bull in the Bharata clan means bull is Shreshtavachakam. It is called Shreshtavachakam. Oh, he is like a bull, he is like a lion. Purusha Simham, we say Purusha Simham means he is such a lion of a man. So something like that. So it is Shreshtavachakam means that is a denoting eminence. Denoting eminence. In that particular clan, you are such an eminent, noteworthy person. So, Bharatarshabha, hey Bharatarshabha. What happens? Rajasi etani jayante viruddhe means Rajasi. Vivruddhe sati etani jayante. That is, when this Rajoguna has become dominant, then etani jayante means all these qualities they manifest. What are they? Lobha. Lobha is basically greed. We know what is lobha. Kama, krodha, lobha, moha. It is one of the six enemies. Six, what are called? Shad, what is this? Enemies. The six enemies, what are they called? Kama, krodha, lobha, moha, mada, matsarya. There is a technique, there is a small term for that. So the six enemies. So this, among the six enemies, this lobha. Lobha is that greed is one. Lobha. That is, he wants to acquire more and more and more. Then pravrutti. And if you want to acquire more and more and more, pravrutti, you are always engaged in action. You are always busy. Just now we saw, even earlier sloka also we saw, he is always engaged, never tiring. Then arambha. Arambha is endeavor, always trying to have a new opening, always trying to, nowadays we call it diversify. You diversify more and more and more. So karmanam ashamaha, totally unending or rather untiring efforts. And spruha, desire. So we will see this, because rajasyetani jayante, we will see this shloka, we will complete this shloka tomorrow. Harihi om tat sat.